So we are talking about metathesis. Metathesis basically means change of place, and if you look at metathesis of two olefins where I have, let's say, methylene groups represented by A and B, then the atoms A and B have changed the position. In this case, you can say they have changed the position of the this A has gone here, and this B has come here, and then you would get this set of molecules. But you can also look at the double bond and say that the double bonds have changed place. And so if you look at the way in which this reaction can be utilized, it's really amazing that you can now change. For example, I just take, say, propylene. This is propylene. I can convert it to trans-2-butene. And this can be very valuable in the petrochemical industry. And in fact, this is the basis of the Phillips process. And the Phillips process was a completely heterogeneous reaction. I think it worked at 600 to 700 degrees centigrade at very high temperature. And you can imagine breaking carbon-carbon double bonds at this temperature. At very high temperatures like this, you can break any bond, for that matter. So this was not very surprising, but it was a very useful reaction. The catalysts were heterogeneous catalysts. Originally, the original catalysts were all molybdenum oxides or tungsten oxides, like so. And what was interesting was the reaction was completely reversible. It was completely reversible. So you could start with butylene and end up with propene and mixture of propene and ethylene and butene. You can start with propene and end up with more useful butene. Because these molecules were easily separable using distillation towers, it was a convenient way of increasing the value of the petro product that was coming out of the gas well. So the only disadvantage was the high temperature that was required in order to catalyze this process. But there are also some unusual observations. One of them is the fact that, of course, most heterogeneous catalysts are black boxes. It is only now with in-situ measurements, in operando measurements, it's possible to look at the way in which these reactions are proceeding. If you look at the early metal halides that were used, they could be combined with aluminum alkyls. And if you think of it, both of them are moisture sensitive. Both of them are moisture sensitive. And yet, a small amount of water was necessary sometimes to get the reaction started. And so these were all some perplexing observations that were made about this. But the most important thing was the utility. The utility of this whole process was extremely good, and so it desperately needed some explanation. How can you make a homogeneous version? Because then the control of the reactivity can be achieved. And secondly, lowering the temperature at which the reaction can be carried out, because at that type of a temperature, only petrochemicals could be utilized. You cannot use, say, pharmaceuticals, which might decompose at that temperature and so on. So there are two things. These two things were so important. The manufacture of reliable catalysts to do this metathesis reaction, and secondly, development of catalysts which would work in an understandable fashion. If you understood the mechanism of the reaction, then you can utilize it a lot better. And this is exactly what was done by Grubbs, Schrock, and Chauvin. And they got the Nobel Prize in 2005 for working on the metathesis catalyst. Grubbs and Schrock developed catalysts, which what is shown for you on the slide here is the Grubbs catalyst and the Schrock catalyst here. Both of them are generated in the lab fairly easily, and they are useful for a variety of purposes. This drug molecule, for example, epothiolone, was made using the Grubbs catalyst. This crucial double bond was made in a single step, and the ring system and the double bond were made using metathesis reaction. This is only one example. There were many other examples where pharmaceuticals and drug molecules were made using metathesis reaction. So, extremely useful, and so it was rewarded appropriately. Like I said, the utility was enormous, and Chauvin basically introduced understanding to the reaction. And that was very important, because as you would see, after the 80s, when they explained these reactions, the reaction took off in an exponential fashion. Okay. So how exactly does it work? Now, whenever we look at reaction mechanisms, the first thing that we realize is that most of these molecules are not things that we can see and follow. How exactly are the bonds breaking, and how are they forming bonds, and so on. We are still a long way away from that type of understanding or visualization. Although in static molecules now we are able to see electron densities. In the case of reaction mechanisms that are happening in femtosecond timescales, it's not going to be easy to see those bonds breaking and forming. And what one usually does is that we hypothesize a variety of mechanisms and then rule out the mechanisms one by one. Many people jump into the fray, and so people form different hypotheses and show how all the facts can be fit to that hypothesis. And in this particular reaction, which is in fact a classic example where there are about four or five mechanisms that were proposed, and only one of them turned out to be right. The one that turned out to be right was the one proposed by Chauvin. So, needless to say, that's why he was rewarded with a Nobel Prize. But I will tell you some of the more interesting mechanisms that were proposed, which all sounded good but didn't work out all right. In around 1975 or so, it was around the 70s, mid-70s, two people called Mango and Snatt-Schneider. Mango and Snatt-Schneider, I think. Two people, Mango and Snatt-Schneider, proposed a mechanism, and the mechanism they proposed was fairly simple. They said that, you know, that the Duard-Chatt-Duncanson model involves withdrawal of electron density from the pi bond and pumping in of electron density into the pi star orbital. So the ethylene behaves like an ethylene in its excited state. So a coordinated olefin is an excited state olefin. And if that is the case, AB star can combine with another AB to generate a cyclobutane. The cyclobutane can now, it's a symmetrical molecule, so one can think of breaking the bond in different fashions. So let's break the bond in one fashion, and that will give you the product AA plus BB. That's what we had written as products. But if the if I broke it in this fashion, I would go back in this direction. So there are two ways in which I can break it. One of them gives you the so-called product. In this case, it's an equilibrium mixture of everything that is going to be formed, because I'll come to that in a moment. Because you have very similar bond energies. Let me finish that then. We have very similar bond energies between AP and AA. So as a result, when you look at petrochemicals, the reaction goes to a completely thermodynamic equilibrium where you get a mixture of all the olefins. And that's why in the first slide when I discussed it, I was telling you that you can have cis and trans and AA and AB and everything possible. It's as if the methylene groups, the A's and the B's, are separately combined with every other possibility of A and B. So how can they propose that a cyclobutane can interact with the metal? After all, cyclobutane seems to be a saturated molecule. So a saturated molecule cannot interact with the metal. That's one argument against it. But the positive point is that cyclobutane is a strained molecule. And you know that strained molecules like cyclopropane and cyclobutane will have bonds which are not along the direction of the line connecting the two nuclei. So if I we usually draw the lines connecting the nuclei and call them bonds. Now the electron density, on the other hand, need not be concentrated along the bonds. So I will show you this in a few minutes, but let me tell you that this mechanism was ruled out using two or three different arguments. One of them was that if this is indeed the case, cyclobutane must be observed as a side product in this whole metathesis reaction. And no amount of searching could reveal the formation of this free cyclobutane, which corresponded to this molecule. Remember, A and B are corresponding to CR2 groups. Okay, both A and B are CR2 groups. So no cyclobutane was observed. However, a very important principle in reaction mechanisms and in general logic is that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So you cannot just say that this is not the right mechanism just because you have failed to generate the evidence. So cyclobutanes may or may not be formed in the presence of metals. I will come to that. By the way, the ring strain in this molecule is 27 kilocalories per mole. And as I was telling you, one of the reasons why these people proposed this was that strained ring systems could interact with metals. And I will give you an example shortly. But first, let me show you the cyclopropane ring opening here. The molecule that I want to show you is that this is quadricycline. Yeah, it's written here. This is quadricycline and this is norbornadiene. Okay, and quadricycline has got both three-membered rings and four-membered rings. Three and four-membered rings. And this makes for it a very strained molecule. And the proposal was the following. The reason why this reaction was also interesting was because if you used sunlight, you could convert quadricycline into norbornadiene into quadricycline. And if this molecule can, this is strained, and so it's got a lot of energy, and you've harvested sunlight and converted it into some chemical energy, you can release it using, if you use a catalyst to do this, heat will be released. So in a sense, you have stored sunlight or stored sunlight as chemical energy. So this reaction was interesting from that point of view, and people were investigating it. What was interesting was that a rhodium complex was capable of doing the ring opening reaction. If you look at the red bonds in quadricycline, conveniently I have colored it red, then quadricycline is becoming two olefins. The four-membered ring is becoming two olefins in quadricycline. So there seems to be some precedent for this reaction. What we are looking at in the metathesis reaction is exactly this. Double bonds are converted to cyclobutane in situ and then reversibly back into double bonds. So here's the instance where you're able to convert, at least go in one direction, convert quadricycline into norbornadiene using a metal complex. This theory survived for a little while, but it didn't survive long. But first, let me show you the cyclopropane bonds. Some of you might know this already, but these are called banana bonds. Or these are the Walsh orbitals. Walsh was a person who first described this type of bonding picture for cyclopropane. Because it was very strained, people were questioning how is it stable, and Walsh was able to explain that there can be two types of bonds. One bonds are pointed inward and the other bonds are pointed outwards. And basically you have to take three CH2 groups which are sp2 hybridized and form the inside bonds and the outside bonds. So this was very convenient because you can use the DCD model now. You can use the DCD model and use one of the HOMOs. This is one of the HOMOs. Two degenerate HOMOs are there in a symmetrical cyclopropane. But the moment a metal approaches, then this can become the HOMO because this can conveniently interact with one of the empty orbitals on the metal. The empty orbital on the metal can accept electron density from the HOMO, and a filled metal orbital can pump an electron density into the sigma star orbital of the Walsh, in the Walsh orbital. So you're doing exactly what DCD model does for an ethylene. You have removed electron density from the sigma bond and you have pumped in electron density into the sigma star bond. So you should be able to break the cyclopropane easily. In fact, there Jack Halpern, whom I have already introduced to you in another lecture, was one who was able to show that this was probably happening, and the way he did it was in the was to add carbon monoxide to the reaction medium. If you add carbon monoxide, you end up making a stable complex which had a carbon monoxide insertion reaction happening. So I can write this molecule now in this fashion. Let me write out the intermediates for you. So this can be RH, CO2, Cl, and this whole thing can be a dimer because the chlorine can bridge. So this is a strained molecule which is now a metallocyclobutane, and this metallocyclobutane in the presence of carbon monoxide inserts carbon monoxide and forms this stable molecule. So he was able to isolate this. So this showed two things. A, it is probably proceeding through an intermediate, which was a metallocyclobutane. And this also showed that the cyclopropane ring can interact with the metal in such a way that it can form an intermediate. And this intermediate can now insert and form carbon monoxide. But what is unfortunate is that this kind of ruled out the fact that this was the pathway that Mango and Schnatzschneider were proposing. They were proposing that cyclobutane would interact with the rhodium, and would ring open it to form two isolated double bonds, right? So they were proposing this whole thing to be happening in situ, whereas Halpern showed that there was an intermediate involved which had metal carbon bonds, and the metal carbon bonds not only broke the cyclopropane ring, but it also inserted carbon monoxide if you added carbon monoxide to the medium. So this kind of stopped Mango and Schnatzschneider's theory, and people started looking at other possibilities. The other possibility that they looked at was the oxidative coupling of alkenes. Okay, now two alkenes are involved, and you remember in the previous class I had told you about oxidative coupling of alkynes to form metallocyclopentadienes. Now you are forming a metallocyclopentane by combining two olefins. You combine two olefins together and you form a metallocyclopentene. So how does that help? Let me illustrate that for you. Here are the carbons. I have removed the hydrogen so that you can follow the reaction fairly easily. Here is a metal atom now. The metal atom forms two bonds. Of course, originally it could, let's make the bonds with the olefin. So let's form a bond like this. And then in situ or incipient formation of bonds like this between the two carbons and the metal and the carbon would lead to a metallocyclopentane. So this is exactly like the cobalt reaction that we talked about. I will put that up in a minute, but this will lead to a ring system which will have the metal between C2 and C3, or metal between C1 and C4. What I have written for you is C1 and C4, but that doesn't mean the other one would be equally feasible. Now, if I can move the metal from between C1 and C4 to C4 and C3, if the metal can jump over to this position. Now you might think that this is kind of a odd reaction. How can this happen? I want to show you. I want to show you how that can happen by writing out for you the metallocyclopentane in the envelope configuration. So here is the envelope configuration I have shown for you on this slide. So if I can move this bond, let me color the bonds slightly differently. So this is, let me say that these two bonds, the yellow bonds are going to be broken and new bonds are going to be formed, which are blue in color. So here you go. This is the movement of one bond. This is the movement of the other bond. And then I would end up with so that is, let me draw it a little more convincingly, since I have a board that I can use. We should be able to. So that's the movement that has happened. So if I were to label it, that would have been the most convenient thing to do. C1, C2, C3, C4. Now I have a bond between C1 and C4, and C3 and C2. C1, C2 bond got broken, and C1, C4 bond got formed. And of course, the metal, moved into this position. So it is almost like you have a walk between two carbons. You have the turning of the metal, which is my hand here, which is just moving the two bonds, right? So it's not very difficult to imagine that happening. And let me go back. So this is the movement that we wrote. And now, if I break the bonds that were earlier formed, I would end up with the metathesis product. Okay. This is the formation of the metallocyclopentane is exactly the same reaction that the cobalt metallocyclopentadiene formation was described to you. Combining acetylenes will lead to metallocyclopentadiene. Combining alkenes will lead to metallocyclopentanes. So this is the mechanism which Grubbs investigated, and he showed that that is probably not happening. And the way he did it was, again, a classic experiment. What he did was he made the metallocyclopentane. He made the metallocyclopentane, heated it, and showed that this metallocyclopentane broke in only one direction. This was the only product that was formed, and this migration of the metal was not happening, and you're not getting these two products. So Grubbs was able to show that the movement of the metal from one metallocyclopentane position to another metallocyclopentane position was not possible. And he did this using methyl groups. You can always argue that thermodynamically, these are the two products that are best suited for breaking this. So what he did was, very simply he did it with deuterium labeling, and then with the same catalysis conditions, these are the metathesis conditions, he showed that only 6% of metathesis had happened. Under the same conditions, 100% metathesis would have happened if I had the metathesis catalyst and just olefins. So here he showed that only so much of it was formed by heating this species. So he made this species mimic those conditions and generated only these two olefins. So one more thing he did, he used the cis and the trans isomers and showed that it was even stereospecific. In other words, if you remember what I told you in the very first slide, it was not leading to CH2 and CH2 double bond CH2 and CD2 double bond CH2 in this when it breaks, you are able to break everything under metathesis conditions. Here this was not happening at all, and most of it was forming in the way in which they are used, way in which they generate. So the third mechanism that I would rule out is the tetracarbene mechanism. So we have ruled out two mechanisms. One is a cyclobutane mechanism. We said that that's not happening. Then the other one is a metallocyclopentane mechanism, and we said that that's not happening. And now we are going to a tetracarbene mechanism. Tetracarbene mechanism is pictured here. If I were to take a mixture of per-deuterated ethylene and ethylene, I would expect CH2CD2 and a mixture of the starting ethylenes, per-deuterated and ethylene itself. There seems to be some kind of a precedence for that. If you remember, when we discussed the generation of carbenes, I told you that this olefin, which has got four nitrogens attached to the double bond, breaks easily and forms a carbene like this. So what we are envisaging is the formation of four carbenes on the metal. Is there any precedence for four carbenes on a metal? That is something that you can ask yourself. The answer is, so far I have not come across a carbene complex which has got four carbenes on the same metal. But as I told you, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So somebody did a clever reaction, and the clever reaction was to bias the reaction in such a way that you can form an intermediate which would have four carbenes on the same metal. Imagine this is a 1,7-octadiene. This is 1,7-octadiene, and if you treat it with a metal, the metal will coordinate to these two olefins. And imagine metathesis happening by forming a tetracarbene. In that case, it will be double bond CH2, double bond CH2, and then this molecule. And then this molecule will, of course, collapse to cyclohexene and ethylene. Because cyclohexene is going to be a very stable molecule that would be formed, in this case, the reaction seems to proceed very well. In fact, this molecule undergoes metathesis to give you these two products. There is absolutely no doubt or difficulty. In fact, the reverse reaction doesn't happen. It's difficult to do the reverse reaction, I should say difficult to do the reverse reaction. I'll tell you how you can do it. This would be the product. I didn't realize that I had a slide showing the tetracarbene intermediate. What they did was they again did a labeling experiment in which they used a mixture of the dideuterated species and the undeuterated species. And now, if I make a tetracarbene, this species will only give me the CD2 species. I don't have to, I can write it like this. And this species will give me only this plus cyclohexene, right? One mole of this and one mole of this and one mole of this and one. So if I take one mole here and one mole here, I will end up with this stoichiometry. Okay, so this is what I would expect for a tetracarbene intermediate. Why? Because entropically, it is best if I break this into a tetracarbene using the metal coordinated in this fashion. So I would end up with only, if tetracarbene was indeed a possible intermediate, I would end up with this ratio of products. But what was obtained was a mixture that was completely random. They got 100% complete exchange, which is like this. CH2CD2 was formed in one mole, which means that there is a random combination of CH2s and CD2s. It is not going in tetracarbene intermediate, which would give you only one mole of CD2 and one mole of CD2CD2 and one mole of CH2CH2. So this was also very disappointing. No reaction seems to be, no mechanism seems to be fitting all the data that is available in the literature. Metallocyclopentane, if you remember the Poisson-Kand, I forgot to mention it. Poisson-Kand, in fact, has an olefin plus an acetylene plus a carbon monoxide. So you know that olefins can undergo oxidative coupling. Tetracarbene is not known as a stable complex, but that's exactly why if you you can propose that as an intermediate, because that intermediate can break to form two olefins. This was also a metal-assisted 2 plus 2 cycloaddition was also very attractive in the beginning as a simple concept extension of DCD model. That also did not work out. So this is where Chauvin's mechanism comes into play, because he said that this is a non-pairwise exchange of methylene groups. Non-pairwise in the sense that if I take a molecule where I have two pairs, here I have a CH2 and the other molecule I have a CD2, I can take a CH2 from here and a CD2 from here and form a ethylene molecule. And so this type of a non-pairwise exchange here, this is telling you this is giving you a pairwise exchange. This is exactly what you would expect from a pairwise exchange. You take two pairs of olefins, and you do metathesis, and you get a single product. A single set of products. Whereas you take another pair, let's put another color here. So you take this pair of olefins, and you end up with this pair of molecules. So this is pairwise exchange. Whereas the non-pairwise exchange suggests that you can take this CH2 and this CD2, you can take this CH2 and take this CD2, and you can take this CH2 and this CH2, and so on. So you can have non-pairwise exchange. This is the non-pairwise exchange, what is observed. And that was exactly what was suggested by Chauvin. So this fits Chauvin's mechanism exactly. So what is Chauvin's non-pairwise exchange? This was, of course, rewarded suitably. I will skip this slide and let me show you the non-pairwise exchange. What he suggested was the catalytically active intermediate is a carbene. Catalytically active intermediate is a carbene. And this carbene can combine with an olefin and form a metallocyclobutane, through oxidative coupling. So the oxidative coupling is a reaction that is involved. But this time, it is not between two olefins. It is actually between an olefin and a carbene. Remember, I told you the insertion reaction happens between an anionic group and a neutral group. The coupling, oxidative coupling, happens between two unsaturated ligands. So the unsaturated ligand in this case is a carbene and an olefin. That's the only difference. So let's take a look at these intermediates. Here is a stoichiometric version of the non-pairwise of the reaction. So here the reaction has happened between a tungsten carbene molecule and another olefin, which has got a heteroatom substituent. Remember, WCO5 would like to have a Fischer carbene coordinated rather than a Schrock carbene coordinated, because it's electron rich, tungsten WCO5, so it'd like to pump in some electron density into the empty orbitals of the carbon. That is difficult. That is difficult in the case of, that's not leading to a stable situation in the case of this molecule, but in the case of this molecule, it forms a stable Fischer carbene. So this molecule is what is the product. How can this happen? This can happen if I have a tungsten CPH coordinated to an olefin and I have the formation of this molecule where I have this pH. If I form this type of a species, then I would end up with a metallocyclobutane. This metallocyclobutane can break to give me a Fischer carbene and another olefin. So the metallocyclobutane can break in two different ways. And that's the reason why you can have metathesis. If I form a metallocyclobutane, I can break this. I will again use two different colors to show you how this can happen. This can break in this fashion. And that will give me back this product. On the other hand, if I break it along the blue lines, I can form these two products. Right? Yeah. So this metallocyclobutane intermediate is formed by the combination of a metallocarbene and an olefin through oxidative cyclization. So in this intermediate, you have plus 2 oxidation state. This is 0 oxidation state. Then this is plus 2 oxidation state. This is oxidative coupling. So let's look at the whole reaction. Let's look at the, I think I have skipped the slide. Just a minute, please. I have missed one slide, but let me escape to, one second, I will show you the the non-pairwise exchange is shown here. This is from the Nobel website. So I've just copied it from there. If I have a metal carbene as an intermediate, here is the metal carbene. I can combine it with two different olefins to form two different metallocyclobutanes, which can release a different carbene each time. So originally you have a single carbene, and that carbene is mixed with another olefin to generate a new carbene, which in this example it is just a methylene carbene and generates a new olefin. Okay, so this reaction, the non-pairwise mechanism that was suggested by Chauvin, was the best mechanism that could explain all the reactions. And I have a variety of proofs for that. What I'm going to do is, one second. What I'm going to do is to show you now how they proved that all the individual steps are known in the literature or could be shown to be correct through new reactions. What we are saying is that a metallocyclobutane, if it is formed, it can interchange with a olefin and a carbene. And there was one reaction that was known in the literature, and that reaction is shown here on the slide for you. It is the conversion of a cyclopropane from cis to trans. And that's thermodynamically, it is good. And platinum was capable of doing it. And it was shown that platinum can do this by forming a metallocyclobutane. This metallocyclobutane can in fact form a carbene olefin complex. The rotation of the olefin around the metal olefin bond leads to the isomer. So here I have shown for you the same. So let's take the cyclopropane. Let's take the cyclopropane and introduce the cyclopropane between two carbon-carbon bonds. The metal is now oxidatively added across the cyclopropane. That gives you a metallocyclobutane. This metallocyclobutane can form a carbene, forms a carbene and a olefin complex. And this olefin can now rotate so that the position of the R group goes from one side to the other. Now I can form a new carbon-carbon bond, which was not there earlier, and have broken another carbon-carbon bond, and it results in a new metallocyclobutane. If I heat this, I will end up with a new cyclopropane. If I had two R groups, I didn't show two R groups because that would be a bit confusing. So I've just shown it for you as up and down. And this is, this was up here, and now it has ended up down here. Okay. So if I have another label, in fact, they did a variety of labeling experiments to show that it is not a phenyl group migration and a hydride migration. It is not a phenyl group by doing a double labeling experiment. What they did was they labeled the carbon and they labeled, and the phenyl, of course, is a label by itself. And then they showed that the carbon moves along with the phenyl group from one position to the other. This is consistent with the reaction that I just showed you earlier, that it is a carbene olefin. It is a carbene and an olefin which is moving. One more example, and I will end here. This is the Tebe reagent. The Tebe reagent, which also catalyzes the exchange of methylene groups, is through the formation of a metal carbene complex. In this case, there are two reagents in organic chemistry known. One is called the potassus reagent, and the other is called the Tebe reagent. This is the Tebe reagent. And both of them share this intermediate, this metal carbene complex as an intermediate. This is very simply, this is titanium double bond CH2. So if I have a ketone or an aldehyde, then this gives me the thermodynamically more stable compound, which is TiO. Which will not be stable, this will polymerize. And this now forms this product. So olefination is done using Tebe reagent. Those of you who are studied this in organic chemistry know that the potassus reagent and the Tebe reagent are good for olefination or methylination. Methylene groups are added. Okay, so this is the way in which it works. Here, of course, to generate the potassus reagent, a methyl group from here and a CH2H. These two, CH3 and H, are eliminated as methane, and you generate the potassus reagent. So one more example is the exchange of a label between the two metallocyclobutanes. This was also done using Tebe reagent. I will skip that example. And this is, of course, whatever I told you earlier is an example of metallocyclobutane in action. So I will skip this. I'll skip this also. If you go to the Nobel website, nobelprize.org website, and you look at Chauvin's mechanism explained, you'll find that they're explaining it in terms of the American square dance. That is something that you can see how two methylene groups can be exchanged. So this is where I was. I will stop here. What we have seen today is basically the mechanism of the metathesis reaction. We ruled out three different mechanisms and showed that Chauvin's mechanism was the best mechanism that fits all the details. I will stop here and we can have some questions if. Pankaj.
Yes, sir. In that argument about the isomerization of cyclopropane, how can it be applied here? Because here, you should have got a cyclopropane here also in the metathesis type of reagent and those two olefins, they could form a metallocyclobutane and form a cyclopropane instead of forming two olefins.
Yeah. So I'm going to use this slide right here. What you're suggesting is that why are you not forming a cyclopropane and a metal? Is that your question?
Yes, sir.
So that is the way by which the catalyst is deactivated. So these are deactivation mechanisms. So if I do this, then the reaction is deactivated. The metathesis catalyst is very efficient, and the formation of the carbene and olefin, that is this pathway, is much more facile compared to the this is much more facile and thermodynamically favorable, so it doesn't get deactivated. Okay, so there are different ways by which the metathesis catalyst gets deactivated. One of them is the cyclopropane formation. Yes. Okay. Sri Vignesh.
Sir, so in the catalyst, do you start with the metal carbene, or how do you activate the reaction?
The catalyst, that's what I told you, both Grubbs and Schrock made carbenes.
Metathesis reactions in general, you need to have a starting material as a metal carbene or some masked metal carbene, otherwise you can't have the reaction, right?
I don't know whether you're listening in the beginning of the class. I said that Schrock made this carbene, Grubbs made this carbene, and these were two homogeneous catalysts which were responsible for revolutionizing the metathesis reaction in the laboratory.
Yes, sir, I might have missed it. I came at a little 5 minutes late today.
Okay. So these are reliable metathesis catalysts. Original metathesis reaction as developed by the Phillips Petroleum Company works at 400 to 700 degrees centigrade. So no drug molecule will survive that kind of harsh condition. So it was the genius of Grubbs and Schrock that led to the revolutionizing of the whole metathesis reaction. We will look at examples in the next class where we will see how this works. By the way, next class will be again a test. It will be on 2nd. We will have a test. It will be an in-class test like last time. Rules are the same. So we will have the next regular class will be only on Friday. all of
the
you
Friday's lecture.
Arko, you're not very audible.
Sir, is the syllabus up to Friday's lecture or today's also?
You can take it up to Friday's lecture. Yeah. I have not set the paper, so I can skip today's class. There is enough material to be covered.
Sir, one more doubt.
Yeah.
So, like, when we saw, like, the coupling reactions in the last class, we saw, like, or the, like, the last two classes, we saw that the alkene, like, the insertion happens in such a way that you have a least hindered group attached to the metal and the bulky part attached away from the metal. So, can something like that happen in this metathesis reaction also? Like, thermodynamically stable products, we'll see only the final product, right? So, here in the middle, due to the catalyst having two cyclopentadiene groups, like there also, can there be a selectivity in which side of the alkene is bound to the metal in that metallocyclobutene intermediate?
So in the Chauvin mechanism, so let's talk only about the right mechanism. So in the right mechanism, you have a metallocyclobutane, right? And metallocyclobutane will form in such a way that the bulky groups are away from the metal. Is that your question, right?
Yes, sir. So that would give only, that would have like a bias towards products formed from that kind of an intermediate rather than the final thermodynamic equilibrium product mixture, right?
Yeah. to a certain extent, yes. But you can push the reaction to give you the thermodynamic ratio of the final products, you know, of the four olefins that you can generate in the reaction mixture. It's not very, very different. The steric factors are there. They do affect the reaction. You're right. Cyclobutane, metallocyclobutane that is formed would like to be serically less hindered. That is generally correct. Those principles are followed, yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we'll stop here if there are no further questions.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, so Grab catalyst is a Fischer type carbene?
Grabs is, it's not a Fischer actually. It's a late transition metal carbene. It's late transition metal carbene, but it doesn't have a heteroatom substituent.
Okay.
You'll notice that the oxidation state of ruthenium in this complex is actually, I was looking at the wrong slide. Yeah. The Grubbs catalyst has got only CHPH. This is one of the Grubbs catalysts. Grubbs and Schrock have got a variety of other variants. But you'll notice that the oxidation state is +2 in ruthenium. And molybdenum also is a high oxidation state catalyst. And that's also not necessarily a Fischer catalyst.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so Wednesday we have a test. We'll start on time, 10 o'clock, and please have the same set of things ready so that you can write and photograph and send the answers immediately. Okay. I hope all of you have got back your marks, because they were sent to you. You should verify whether you have been given the marks based on the answers that were there.